Well, it's about that gun season time of the year. I mean, it's hard to believe. You know, our rut, we're right in mid-rut right now. And the rut will really go good here in southwest Wisconsin for the next, let's say, week, maybe 8 or 9 days. Boy, I see it really winding down by the 14th, 15th of November. And that happens every year. It's not to say there's not a little rutting activity even extending into the gun season, which will be around the 20th this year in Wisconsin. But I know Michigan starts the 15th for the gun season, and Pennsylvania is the Monday after Thanksgiving. So there's a lot of gun season coming up right now. And I wanted to bring you my top 10 tips for gun hunting. And if you just want to go out and have fun and maybe get a chance at some does or young buck, maybe have that monster wander by, and you just do it to have fun, and you don't really, you know, this all should be fun, but if you don't want to put a lot of effort into it, maybe this isn't for you. And so I'm not saying there's anything wrong with that, but I know a lot of hunters that they have those dreams of those big bucks or the biggest bucks in the area. And I want to give you some tips to help you experience those big bucks, not only this year, but on a consistent basis going forward. So these are my top 10 tips for making sure that you find success during gun season every single year. And I'll start out with number one. We're in a beautiful redneck blind right here. And it is a luxury to be able to hunt out of these. I never dreamed that I'd be able to hunt out of these, in the past. And being able to hunt out of this blind is great, but we had this blind set out here in August. And so we've had our access to this blind planned. We access from behind a ridge to my right, and we really are hidden getting up to this blind. We just have to stay low when we crest the ridge, sneak into the back of this. And the deer that are out in these food plots around, there's three food plots between 120 and stretching back to 250 yards in different directions. And so we can get in and out of this blind without spooking deer. But number one, we've set this blind way in advance. And it's not just that. We planted the switchgrass around here in front of this blind to help soften the blind here. We planted that switchgrass 2 and 3 years ago. So we've been planning for this setup and this location for a long time. So it wasn't just getting out here and getting this blind in early so the deer get used to it. It wasn't just the access getting in and out, but it was really important to have our screening here so that when you're down in those food plots back here, you might see a roof line. Right now it's part of the snow that just covers the ground, but we've planned this long in advance for this blind location. And hey, if you're throwing a blind up just in the last few days right now, the week or two before the deer season, in my experience, those deer see it. Those big bucks greatly avoid it. Does get fast. They get used to things a lot faster than a mature buck, even the oldest does. They'll get used to it because they're herd mentality. They do the same things every day unless you disrupt it. A mature buck, he's an independent thinker. He loses his buddy as he ages, if you think of it that way, and he has to decide on his own and use his own wits to keep him out of trouble. And part of that trouble is when you have your blinds located, where they're located, if they're hidden enough, and your ability to get in and out of a blind that is well hidden is incredible during the deer season. Now, number two, when you come into access opening morning to me determines a lot of your success. You going into that blind, just that half hour, 20 minute trek, 10 minute trek, whatever you have going into your blind. My philosophy, I like to beat everybody in the woods. And so whether you're getting into your stand, your blind, your tree stand in the woods, all set up an hour before daylight, an hour and a half before daylight, 2 hours before daylight, whatever it is, I look at it like there's an army, an onslaught of people heading to the woods, and I want to beat that army, the majority of them, for the high percentage, and get into my spot, let it settle down so that my spot at daybreak is the quietest in the neighborhood and not someone else's. One of the greatest strategies that I can offer, and this maybe should have been put at number one, but you can always find those neighbors that have the most intrusive behavior when it comes to hunting and their hunting strategies. They really make a lot of noise getting in and out of their stands or blinds. And what I like doing is putting a lot of thick cover between myself and that neighbor, especially if I think the deer are going to come from that way, older bucks. That paid off big time for me with a buck in 2013. It was 160 some inch buck that we knew was over towards the neighbors. And so we went way out of our way to put about a quarter mile of property edge between us and that neighbor. And then them more haphazardly entering their blinds and moving into their stands opening morning pushed a lot of deer away, including that big one. Shot him about 10:30 in the morning, so we slowly worked our way. But setting up on the backside of bedding area where you think the highest amount of pressure is going to be coming from, and that also includes public land. So if I've always used public land. I've shot 14 bucks in 18 years out in Pennsylvania hunting. And the way I shoot a lot of those deer is I'd get in, I'd forego breakfast in the morning with the guys. I'd get way out on public land, hour and a half walk. And I would set up in bedding areas, low benches, areas that are hidden, and it takes a lot of people, a lot of time for hunters to get to, more late morning, mid morning, so that I was sitting in the backside of that area, thick cover, waiting for hunters to push deer to me. And some of those areas didn't even have a lot of sign. They just had the perfect amount of cover. And so if you're looking for sign, if you're looking for rubs and scrapes, you have to ask yourself, even on public land or private, is this a remote area where deer are going to feel safe and they're going to come to hide during gun season? Or is this out in the open, field edges, areas where deer can't hide and will not seek shelter in when the guns start blazing and the army hits the woods? I want to be in that remote area, sign or not, and I want to be in that thick area where those deer seek during the hunting season. Now, we'll talk about some morning and evening setups. This is a perfect evening setup, and this is where I would hunt opening day in the afternoon, because we have food sources down here and we can approach without spooking any of the deer on those food sources. We're coming in from a long ways away behind a steep ridge, thick cover, and we can get in and out without spooking these deer. And so this is more of an exception to the rule. Even opening morning, we found in high winds, the deer will be down in that draw in front of us, and that's often a great location to set up for, even an opening day in the morning, because we don't get a lot of deer running around here. There's so much cover they can run into. Number four, something that is strictly forbidden in my camp, and it should be in yours, and definitely in my clients that I talk to. I've had a few clients break these rules, and it has destroyed their property in an instant. And that is, opening day of gun season is the most sacred time in the woods. That's for buck hunting. If you're out there blasting does on opening day, you're going to wreck your property, especially the small properties I deal with. My average client has 100 acres. I hunt properties that are 52 acres, 25 acres, and 40 acres. A lot of my clients, 50% of my clients, have 60 acres or less. The last thing you should be shooting on opening day is a doe. When does do the same thing all season long, very easy to pick them off when you need to. And opening day should be the most secure time in the woods. Think of it that you can afford to be haphazard, shoot does, reduce population in the beginning of the season and at the end of the season. But in the middle of the season, especially opening day of deer season, you're property should be at its best, and if you're shooting does, it's not at its best. Now, I say don't shoot does. If you already have a buck down on the ground and you have a couple mature does standing around and you need to thin the herd, what an opportune time to take some does out without adding pressure to the land, because you already have to go in and remove those bucks anyways, that buck that you shot. So perfect time to shoot a buck and then opening day, and then turn your rifle to the nearest does and reduce the doe population. Now, this could be a hard one. And obviously, for sitting up in a fancy blind like this, we might not necessarily need to, but one of the best times to shoot a buck that I've found since the late 80s is at lunchtime, because half the hunters at least are heading home, heading to the shack, heading to their camper, heading to their cabin to have lunch. And that added movement, out here in these hills, especially with snow, deer can see hunters from 400 yards away along the hillside. You can see that shape walking in the snow. So I actually like snow. I like crunchy snow for opening day, because I'm a sitter. So I like sitting all day out there. I'm the one that's not moving. I'm the one that's not pushing deer. But boy, you leave for lunch and you push those deer out. They're not coming back till night, and they might not come back for a few days. So consider bringing your lunch with you, and consider at least for opening day, sticking it out all day. I know a lot of you do. But it's a great strategy, and it not only is for getting a buck on opening day, but preserving your land, like not shooting does, like being able to enter into a hidden blind, good access. You're really looking at not just opening day, but how is your hunt affecting the week and 2 weeks after if you're hunting haphazardly on your land. Number six, now I love opening morning. That's tradition. I'm gonna be out in the woods. I love opening morning because I feel like you can get out in the woods and wait for the deer to come to you, especially in a very thick area. You've done everything right. You set up your land ahead of time, your blinds, your access, your screening. You get in, get out, and it's an all-day sit time. Day number two, sometimes the same thing. We'll go in, and my stepson Dante went in for a morning hunt. I think it was in 2017 or 2016, and he shot his first buck on a morning sit on the second day. So second day can be great, especially if you can get in and out and you know you're not going to spook deer. Maybe they're down in the ag fields or they're in big open hardwoods or they're in a swamp or they're on bait piles if you have baiting in your area. And you can slip in and out of your blind. But if you're at a food source, if you're in an area where you might spook deer, then really try to focus after that first or second day of gun season, putting your energy into those afternoon hunts, making sure that you can go in with your eyes open, that you can see, that you can sneak maybe on the backside of a bedding area or between bedding and food in the afternoon, where you can take advantage of the gun and sit back and enjoy that movement without potentially going in the morning and destroying that movement with deer that are already in their bedding areas and secure areas because they've been pushed there on opening morning, the second morning, by the time you get in the third, fourth. I like after gun season settled down a week or two and you get into the muzzleloader seasons, you get into December, then I'll take a chance on some morning hunts away from bedding areas on remote food sources, browse areas where they're feeding on hardwood regeneration, even acorns. When there's snow and it warms up, when you get that soft snow and it's 10 o'clock in the morning, 11 o'clock, 12, you get those deer coming out of their bedding areas and feeding heavily, especially if it's bitter cold on opening morning. They're already in their beds. So if you can sneak in an area that's away from their beds, you know they're already there, they're pinned down, and then wait for them to come out. That's when I start focusing maybe again on a couple morning sits. But again, the evening you should really focus on. There's a high priority, especially the later the season gets, with deer really putting the feed bag on, especially when you get these early snows like this on November 5th and 6th, and an evening turns into a great hunt. But don't forget about mornings, opening day, second day, and those late seasons too. For the most part, we're hunting evening for the bulk of the season. Now seven, this is something that I've been doing for years and I really enjoy doing it. Shot a beautiful 60 inch plus buck on the ninth day, the last day of Wisconsin's 2015 gun season. And I shot him with my bow. And I like hunting with my bow during gun season. There's times where I'm hunting in a pinch point, I'm hunting in a funnel, and yeah, I might miss something going by because I don't have the gun and I can't reach through a nice little hole at 50, 60, 70 yards. But a lot of times my stands are set up for bow movement. They're taking advantage of travel corridors, natural funnels in the woods, benches, saddles, natural land constrictions of movement. And so I'm in areas that are pretty tight anyways. Again, I'm hunting back in the brush and near cover, near bedding areas a lot of the time. And so try a bow. If you love bow hunting, don't be afraid to try it out. You can get mad at me, I guess, if you blew an opportunity on a big buck. But I really like shooting my bow. I don't mind shooting with a gun or a muzzleloader. I still hunt with my guns and muzzleloaders a lot. But really consider using a bow. To me, it's fun and it matches the habitat that you should often be hunting during gun season, especially on opening day, the second day. There's been several in the last years that I've sat more with my bow on opening day than without. Now, we're getting into the fun part, you know, bringing a bow and stepping up to that challenge on opening day of gun season is a fun thing. But another thing is, if you're gonna sit all day, which I encourage you to do on opening day, second day, maybe even later, but bring a lot of goodies and have some fun. You know, I'm diabetic and I shouldn't be having a lot of snacks, but if I want to make an exception, opening day, bringing out our favorite candy bars, maybe some beef jerky, and of course something to drink. And Diane and I, we sat together last year for opening day, and we actually brought a thermos. I got our thermos so we can bring out some coffee or some hot chocolate on opening day, especially for sitting in a blind and utilizing the area where we can get away with a lot of movement. But goodies help pass the day. And I know there's a lot of people out there that gun hunt that don't, they're not those hardened bow hunters that sit all day like we do. I sat all day, I had to sit on all day on Sunday where it didn't get above freezing. And it was cold. It's a long day. You have to mentally prepare yourself. But boy, when you have goodies and snacks and maybe some coffee in the blind, you know, you can bear it and it makes your gun hunt a lot more fun. Number nine with heat packs. I've become a big fan of heat packs throughout the years. I can readily say that the Heat Factory heat packs hold their heat a lot longer than the other brands. I won't even mention the brands I don't like, but I avoid them like the plague. We find the heat packs, we use large ones. Use a hand warmer tube. So we put two in the hand warmer tube to keep our hands warm. And I use thin gloves like the ones I have on right here. I put those in the hand warmer tube with a couple of heat packs, and I stay toasty warm in any environment, especially with a high quality hand warmer tube like I use from Sitka. So it's got windstopper material in it, very insulated. But heat packs, there's so many times you get chilled on stand, and this happens with my wife especially. She's a newer hunter, getting used to this cold, and that mindset. Really golden opportunity and a luxury when you can actually pull out a heat pack when you're chilled, put it inside your bibs next to your core, put two of them there, wear boots that you can throw them in. But heat packs can save the day and make your hunt so much more comfortable instead of going through the torture of being very cold. Number 10, what's really important to me is along the heat pack line is I like several layers on my head. In fact, this hood right here, the black one or the coat right here has a built-in face mask. So I can put that over, have the face mask right here. But a lot of times I'm not stopping there. I use some type of Gore-Tex or Windstopper hat. Sitka has the GTX hat, which is a favorite of mine, where it has a fold-down ear flaps. And even that's not enough sometimes. I'm using a heavy face mask, then I'm using the hood, and then I'm using that on top. So I have several layers, including a Windstopper or a Gore-Tex type layer, where the wind cannot penetrate, the weather cannot penetrate, and I'll have three or four layers on my head to keep me warm. And I'll zip these right up like this. You can see right now, the jacket I wear underneath a lot zips up, and then my merino wool base layer right here zips up. So I can not only zip those all up and have a lot of material around my neck, and they're made to layer, so there's plenty of movement. But then at the same time, when I'm walking in, it's all unzipped. So I'm letting the air go straight up. And with these walks in here, we have 35-minute walks up to some of our blinds and stands, over 40 at sometimes. And so you get really heated up. And so those layers on your head, like I said, the hand warmer tube, I've been using one since my mom sewed one for me when I was 15, I believe, and couldn't afford to go to Dunham's and buy the one they had there. So that hand warmer tube is so critical. I carry my grunt call in it. I carry extra batteries for the camera. I carry my phone in there, carry my gloves. And it's not only a little bit of a fanny pack type thing, but it keeps my hands warm. And it's something I never go out in the woods without. It doesn't matter if it's blistering hot or just bitter cold. I have that hand warmer tube on me to carry everything I want. I actually put my hats in the side where it's strapped. Put a face mask on the side so I'm not putting it in my sweaty hand warmer tube. I'm keeping them on the outside of my body. But great for extending those days and making your day comfortable. And finally, bibs, your core area, a quality vest, making sure your core is warm. You can have a little bit of thinner layer on your arms, but you cannot sacrifice your head, toes, and body. And that brings me to the last point is not only quality boots, but quality boots with room. We were walking up here right now, and Diane has her heavy lacrosse boots on. I think they're 1800 or 1600 gram thinsulate, and there's a lot of movement in them because she's wearing thin socks. We're not coming out here to hunt right now. We're making some preparations on the blind, and we can do it in a hidden way, but she's sliding around a little bit. That comes in real handy when you want to add an extra layer of heavy socks, and if you still have a little room left over, throw in the heat packs under your arch when you get in your blind, on top of your toes. You can turn just about any boot into a comfortable boot for an all-day gun sit when you're using heat packs. That extends to bow season too, but boy, it starts to get cold right now, and it already is. I'm looking in the forecast, there's more 20s and 30s over the next 2 weeks. So I hope you enjoy those 10 tips for enjoying your gun hunt and for having a better gun hunt. It's not just about strategy and going out for a big buck and how to do that. It's getting your blinds prepared, making sure you're not shooting does in opening day, making sure you're in your stand blind early enough. A lot of these, I know that a lot of you do already do this, but there's a lot of people that hit the channel that are younger hunters, less experienced hunters, that just haven't been practicing and putting to practice these, and maybe want to up their game. And I hope that's you. I hope you enjoy these strategies on the site. And if you enjoy these strategies on the channel, and you like the videos out, you're going to love my books. They're all about strategy. They're Whitetail Strategy. I'm in the process of getting my 6th book out, and I'm hoping that'll come out before Christmas time, but we'll hope for that anyways. But they're all about Whitetail Strategy and how to hunt. I even have a kid's book thrown in there. And I think you really like them. They'll detail a lot of these strategies a lot more. I want you to have a successful gun season, most of all, a safe gun season. And I want to hear about it in the comments down below. I hope these tips help. And boy, I hope you have a lot of fun. Don't forget to snack up when you get out there. Bring some food, maybe some coffee. Enjoy your sit. And, you know, I look at it like if you smell a little bit extra, yeah, maybe even you have a little heater in your blind, the number one form of scent control is where your blinds or stands are located. So if you can get to them effectively, you're not leaving a scent trail. Once you get on stand, deer shouldn't be downwind of you anyways. And if you take all these tips, I know you can have an enjoyable gun season this season and beyond, and I want to hear about it. Thank you.